Good evening and welcome. My name is Derek Adey, and it is my very great privilege to serve as Dean and Director of the Virginia Institute of Marine Science and the School of Marine Science at William & Mary. I want to welcome you all here on what is for us a really very special evening. For those of you that don't know us, I want to welcome you first here to Gloucester Point. This is one of our primary campuses, but I also want to point out that we have several hundred people online from more than 30 states and 13 countries who are joining us as well. So this is a very special night for us here. For those of you that don't know us well, we are the Virginia Institute of Marine Science, or VIMS. We are one of the largest marine research and education facilities in the country. And we are squarely tackling the grand global challenges associated with coastal and marine systems through the really outstanding work of our faculty, staff, and students. And tonight is a really special part of that work as we celebrate the inception of a new scholar and ocean residency. My colleague Kirk Havens has the honor of introducing the scholar and ocean residency, Mr. Nainoa Thompson, but I'll say that I'm particularly enthusiastic about getting to know him, about the partnership potential between our organizations, and I'm especially excited that we all have the chance tonight to get to spend some time with someone who is really making a difference for our planet. Before we do that, I want to take this opportunity to give a very special welcome to our honored guests, the chiefs of five local tribes, Chief Frank Adams of the Upper Mattapani Tribe, Chief Lynette Alston of the Nottoway Tribe, Chief Keith Anderson of the Nansum Tribe, Chief Robert Gray of the Pamunkey Tribe, and Chief Ann Richardson of the Rappahannock Tribe. Thank you all so much for being with us as we welcome our two guests from the Polynesian Voyaging Society, Nainoa, who is the president of the society, and Lehua Kamaleu, their voyaging director. I also want to take this opportunity to thank Bank of America for helping support the Scholar in Ocean Residency. As I mentioned, VIMS is the home of William & Mary School of Marine Science, and I'm grateful to have William & Mary's 28th president, Dr. Catherine Rowe. Catherine, would you bring greetings from William & Mary?
Thank you, Derek. Thanks and welcome to everybody in the room and online. I'm Catherine Rowe, privileged to be the president at William & Mary. And I'm so thrilled to be here tonight. I'll echo Dean Adey's welcome to the chiefs of our five local tribes. We are so grateful for two decades and more of partnership advancing resilience in our coastal communities with you. It's incredibly important work. The campuses at VIMS and at William & Mary, our communities are estuarine communities. That means we know directly the challenges that are being experienced in coastal communities around the world. Here in the Tidewater and Hampton Roads, over the last 100 years, we've seen a foot and a half of sea level rise. And the predictions say that it will be 5 feet of sea level rise by the year 2100. That's sobering. So these partnerships, the research we do here and at William & Mary are incredibly important. Our new strategic plan, Vision 2026, takes water as one of its cornerstones. That's not right. You can't say takes water as a cornerstone, can you? A dominant current of work for our strategic plan. And we do that because we recognize how absolutely crucial conservation, coastal stability, flooding, the ecosystems that support our coastal communities are. We have extraordinary research here. You all know in this room the prowess of the science that happens here at VIMS to protect and secure our coastal communities and our aquaculture and the environment. You also know I hope more broadly that at William Mary in the law school, in law and policy, in arts and sciences and geosciences, in environmental sciences, in economics, we have extraordinary breadth of research that is partnering with VIMS as part of the strategic plan under Dina Day's leadership. We aim to educate the next generation of industry professionals, conservation scientists, and policymakers who can ensure that we keep our aquasystems fresh and salty, inland, coastal, and deep ocean thriving, because it's that is going to keep our communities thriving. So it's a particular honor to be able to welcome global navigator Nainoa Thompson and members of his team to teach us more about our own waterways and our own communities. It's wonderful to have you in residence here on our campuses and in our waters, and we look forward to what we can learn from you. Thank you.
So we do a really wide range of things at VIMS, but central to the work that we do is resiliency and coastal systems. And Dr. Kirk Havens is the director of our Center for Coastal Resources Management. He's also a longtime friend of Nainoa, and I'd like to ask Kirk to come forward now.
Again, Dina Day, Madam President, and guests, thank you very much and good evening. Before I introduce our speaker, I would like to acknowledge our tribal guests online and our tribal chiefs in the audience. You know, it's you and your ancestors that have been stewards of the land and water for thousands of years. And we honor you and the Virginia Indian community's commitment to the protection of our natural resources, and I thank you. Before I introduce our speaker tonight, we have a short video that we would like to share to provide some background. So,
these miracles of these voyagers that started to discover all these islands, it's like the eighth wonder of the world. How did they do that so far back in time? There's two things of genius in Polynesian. Someone needed to build a vehicle, a spaceship of our ancestors, that could sail far when no other culture on Earth was sailing far. The other is you had to navigate to find a way to and from. The navigator needed to be able to see, needed to be able to hear, it needed to be able to feel. Every day, that navigator would maybe making 5,000 observations of a wave or a bird or a star. It would make 500 choices about trim, course, steering, and then it would make two decisions. At sunrise and sunset, in the color of light of dawn and dusk, it would make decisions about where are you on the earth. I think we are where we are on the planet today, where human beings are changing the earth. It is now turning around and changing us, and we don't know what to do because we disconnected. The greatest thing we need to do is become family of the earth again, family of nature. The greatest naturalist I've ever met was my teacher, Mālama, who transcends the observation of nature to what he calls the magic. It is about when the human existence becomes part of the family of nature, that you are nature. The thing about Mao, the day he was leaving, packing his bag, he sat me down and said, okay, Nainoa, I give you everything. And the ocean showed you everything, but it'll be 28 years before you'll see. If you want someone to know everything, send your son, because you're too old. That's a crucial piece of cracking the code. And it's when we teach our children. When do you learn the connection? When do we learn verbal language? When do we learn the language of nature? And that's the language we need to immerse ourselves. We need to bring it back. We need schools of nature immersion globally. And that's why we're voyaging. To just getting general awareness to half the population of the earth, getting understanding to a quarter population of the earth, and getting the sense of values back to a billion people. And then going down the road from values, you need to reinstate respect. Then you need to reinstate care. And then from there, where values are now moving to action, that's when you need to help strengthen a community and a culture that's global, not based on race, but based on values. The voyage itself will take about 400 crew members from, we're hoping, about 26 countries. Diversity and equity and access matters. That this is not just a Hawaiian voyage, this is a global voyage. We'll be at sea for about 450 days, and we'll be on land for 950 days. Every day is a story of ideas and people. You cannot make this movement by yourself. You have to have communications and education platforms that can get it to the billions. And then you need to have partners that are gonna essentially strengthen the stories, help us to access communities. We will probably go to maybe 220 indigenous territories to make sure that these people have voice. When you try to imagine, add up how much goodness people are actually doing as individuals, not collected, not organized, not institutionalized, we should never do that. Just let that wave happen, let that movement happen. What about hope anymore? We don't have time for hope. We need to begin getting started in believing that we can make that change.
Tonight we have a very special guest and the beginning of a very special partnership, our new VIMS scholar in Ocean Residency, Nainoa Thompson. Nainoa is the president of the Polynesian Voyage Society and has led a rediscovery and a revival of the ancient Polynesian art of navigation using only the stars, waves, and nature. Through his voyaging and on the traditional sailing canoe, hukulea, he and his crew have initiated a global discussion on the importance of sustaining ocean resources and cultural heritage. People and organizations have bestowed upon numerous accolades upon him, including His Holiness the Dalai Lama's Unsung Hero of Compassion Award, National Geographic Society's oldest and most prestigious honor, the Hubbard Medal, the Seakeeper of the Year Award, and membership in the Ocean Elders. Archbishop Desmond Tutu remarked upon the arrival of the hukulea in South Africa, saying, and I quote, "It's uplifting to those who look at you, who read about you, who see you." However, Nainoa will tell you that he is just a sailor and a fisherman, and more importantly, a student of great teachers. The phrase, "a student of great teachers," resonates with us as faculty at one of the world's top marine science institutes, as we have the humble honor to be teachers of great students. For we know it is this generation that must take up the mantle as stewards of the earth and develop diverse friendships across the planet, friendships based on the values of caring, of respect, and of the knowledge that the ocean and the water connects us all. Now I'd like to introduce Lehua Kamalu, the first woman in Polynesia's 4,000 year history to be the lead captain and lead navigator on a traditional voyage from Hawaii to Tahiti. She navigated the 2,400 miles without instruments, using only the knowledge passed down from the elders. Leo.
Aloha, I'm Lehua. I was just gonna share a few words. That chant was actually written for the crew of Hokulea, the canoe that you just saw a few clips of. And it describes what it's like to be on the ocean. It describes the cliffs that have the waves. It describes the sound of lashings as they crack as it rides over these swells, and is really meant to share just where we come from as people of Hawaii. We are really ocean people. And as you said, Kirk, this ocean and our waters are what connect us, and is really meant to give you a sense of who we are and request permission and your, our gracious welcome of being hosted here by VIMS and by the people whose ancestral lands we are gathered on here today. Mahalo.
I know.
On behalf of the Nias and the Indian Nation, we welcome you and bring you, extend our blessings and open arms. Thank you.
I'm excited that you're a woman. This is Ann Richardson from the Rappahannock Tribe, and I welcome you. I saw your presentation many years ago at the Polynesian Cultural Center in Waikiki, and I came home amazed at what I was watching, and I cried because that tradition has been kept by your people so that we could have it today. So God bless you both and your whole crew. From our tribe. Welcome to Virginia.
On behalf of the Pamunkey tribe, welcome again. We saw you here about five some years ago, but we'd like to welcome you again to this land that we natives call Senecumica.
From the inland waterway of the Nainoa tribe of Virginia, we're happy you're back. We were with you before when you arrived, and we gave you permission and love to be with us then. We welcome you back, and we share our love once again. Nainoa.
On behalf of the Upper Mattaponi tribe, located on the Mattaponi River, we extend our arms and welcome you to our land, our territories, and to all that we have. Thank you.
Now it is my great pleasure and true honor to introduce to you a sailor, a fisherman, a student, a friend, Nainoa.
Oh my God.
Wow, really nervous. Hello, Mike Ako. Thank you all for coming. In the Pacific, we're scared of 5 feet of water drowning our islands, taking away the homeland of 4,000 years of our people who took care of those islands. Children are scared. They're writing poetry for things that are dying. When VIMS talks about its goal of solutions, you know, a lot of people say that. But I've only been here in VIMS for 2 days. And, you know, we've been treated with grace and respect and aloha at the highest level, from leadership to executive decisions to faculty and students. But it's a time with the students where I don't know them, but I don't feel the fear. I feel courage and strength. And when we talk to them about their role, which is rare in education institutions that I know, it is such a strong public purpose that has to come together with inclusion of everyone to create any solution. But there's one thing that they must have, exactly what you did tonight, to honor Lehua and myself. They need your permission. They need to work with you. I am going to talk about, and I really want to bring forward the great navigator. And I know Kirk kind of, you know, these awards are for ideas. They're for the movement of a whole communities. I'm just one of thousands of people. And so please, my words are not about humility, it's about the truth. I'm not going to accept that kind of accolade that is not mine, because nothing in voyaging can be achieved by yourself. It takes the whole family. And so we know from our teachers how important it is that it's not just indigenous knowledge. It's deeper than that. It's indigenous genius. Because we're talking about, I don't know how many, 10, 12,000 years of sheer stewardship at the highest level, because you're still here. And the world's going to need this integration. I will talk about it. But I really am very impressed at what would be described as, rightfully so, president and to the dean, the leadership that up to this date sees VIMS as the one of the top five marine schools in the world. But what I heard today was nothing about that. What I heard today was about public purpose, connection to community, bringing in so much more indigenous knowledge. It is crucial for us to really understand, not just understand, but crack the code and break the rules about what's been holding us back from being good stewards. And I really am, just so you know, Lehu and I are deeply honored to stand on your soil, because this movement to come together as a larger family that defines your whole community in Virginia is such a powerful story, which needs to be happened across the world. We are really selfish on our next voyage. We want to take Hokulea and shine the light on communities that have hope, that are moving towards action, that are doing things. And so what our children don't need is more stories of why everything's so bad, because it's not. It's okay to be afraid, but it's not okay not to act. And so this is how I feel before the president has to go, because she has a memorial to go to, and we understand. Hokulea is going to be 50 years old in 3 years. She's crossed 300,000 nautical miles. She's traveled. My generation are stepping off, pushing the younger generation forward, because we must. If we don't do that key piece, it's going to die. What we need to look towards, this presentation tonight's looking back at 50 years. The real question is looking forward to 50 years. Who does that? It's the family of the place that we live in. Needs to make decisions for its home. And it takes everybody. And the crucial thing that I see that was created here is you came together and unified. Because we know if we're divided, we'll do nothing. So honored, privileged, because I believe that the big question is, who in the future are going to be the navigators to change the course of humanity, to have it more respectful to the earth, to understand its relationship? Because you can't protect what you don't understand. And you won't if we don't care. Native people love their land, and that's why they'll protect it, because of that love. And that has to be across all of humanity. And when I think about where the great navigators, I met so many today for tomorrow. But the question is, where's the navigation schools? And I would say, this family that I've met today at this institution, the family that I've met in the past, and thank you again 6 years later, for our crew, do not forget your kindness and your compassion and your care for the canoe and for them. I just want to say that here is a school that's important for the earth. Privilege and honor to be here and to make sure that you understand that Lehu and I come here with massive humility, because we're learning all the time. And what's so beautiful, we take it home and we put it on the canoe and we sail for it, because it's worth it. I do want to thank everyone, and especially President Roe for being here, and your leadership, and Dr. Ade has been just so kind to share and help me understand how much magnificence is happening here. I'm not going to even to one slide. This is going to about 10:30 tonight, but I'm really just expressing how moved I have been, and so grateful to be able to understand what education should look like, and more importantly, what it should feel like. And I'm moved and I'm inspired, and maybe we can end this. You don't even need to go through this stuff, because what you're doing is way more inspiring than what we did. But this presentation, before I lose the president, I wanted to talk a bit about Lehua before you go. Got to break the rules if they're wrong. And it hurts sometimes. It's painful sometimes. But if you don't break them, you just give it to your kids. And in Voyaging, I will talk about the rule breaking that would have a culture that protected its navigation for 4,000 years. Doesn't even teach across family lines and then would teach it to us. That was a massive rule breaking. Our teacher, Mao Pialug, he was a champion at breaking the rules because he knew what was right from wrong. But one of the issues that we were challenged with when we started to move forward and towards succession, you see, when we started Voyaging, it was the assumption. Front page of the paper in 1976, there are 12 men voyaging to Tahiti plus two women. What does that mean? When you walk to some of the canoe construction sites, there are signs up that say, no women on the walk of site. And when you go to certain island groups, if you're a woman, do not step on the shadow of the men's house, and we will not teach you stars. That's why I was talking to you about the brilliance of your dark, untampered places, where the cosmos comes close. And so, we had a problem in the 90s. It was a woman that would rise to the top of the class in learning navigation. Men were given the graduation by a teacher called pole. And pole means it graduates you into deep sea voyaging, allows you to take the canoe, to go deep sea without your teacher, with all the accolades, but more importantly, all the responsibility. And that pole ceremony is really a ceremony so that succession is successful. Otherwise, it goes extinct. And so our problem was Kailani Murphy was so good that she needed to advance, but we couldn't because we didn't have permission. I go down to Micronesia in 2008. My teacher, Ma, was very sick with diabetes. His island's very isolated in Micronesia and very hard to get to. And I knew that, and he knew this would be my last trip to see him. The man that's trained us for 30 years. And so we talked a lot and we didn't want to say goodbye because how do you do that? So we talked about he'll always be there if we sail. Because if the star comes, it's him. If the bird comes, it's him. If the wave comes, it's him. Because in his world, as a navigator, you are all those things. You are the wave. You are the bird. You are the fish. You are the moon. You are the sun. And that's how you graduate. So we talked about, okay, as long as we sail and we see the bird, you're with us. And he said, yes. So we said, okay, I'll see you soon. With the instructions, we got to sail. But that day that I went to see him was the day before we were going to leave. He lived on the other side of the island from where the boat was anchored. Small, tiny island. It's a mile and a half long, half a mile wide. And I had this problem, Kailani. So when I was leaving, I turned to him and said, hey, Mao, can I give po to women? Here's the man that breaks all the rules to make a just world. Turn to me, and when he's angry, his eyes get red. And he turned to me and said, no. And the way he said no, don't ask him again. So I left without permission. I knew if I come back to my community by the values that we speak about and do not have equity at the top of the list, it'll fracture and break our organization. Because it's not porno. It's not just. And so I went back because we knew we were going to pull the anchor at the sunrise. So I went back and the next morning I was just like walking in circles on the sand because I was just confused about what am I going to do? And I kept going in circles and guys are yelling at me on the ship, get on a boat. If we're going to pull the anchor, leave you here. And I just turned around and ran. I kept running and running and getting stronger and stronger. And I just take the boat. I was, because I had to go see Mao. When I went back around the island to his it's a room that it's his house. No windows, no doors. His bed is a piece of plywood and a tiny little pillow. And he was there waiting for me. So we came in uncomfortably in that kind of moment when, you know, what, why'd you come back? And why are you waiting? And so we talked for a little while, but I couldn't ask the question again. So I turned away, said, okay, Mao, I will see you later. And when I turned, he goes, hey, Nainoa, you want to give po to the wahine? And I said, yes, because they deserve it. And he turned around and said, the most beautiful, genius answer that native people figured out. They figured out. He goes, up to you. Because what he said was, he can't do it. He can't break the rule. But you were just given permission for you to break it. And so I'm kind of changing this whole presentation, but Kailani navigated Hokulea back. So when we came back from the worldwide voyage, we were in Tahiti coming home from the 34th crew change. And after 37,000 miles, who brings the canoe home? Should it be some old goat like me bringing the canoe? Nobody would care. It should be a demonstration of change. So we pushed Kailani out there with a captain, woman from Big Island, with Captain Bruce Blankenfeld that took the canoes to your communities that would just help them along. And she navigated the canoe all the way back to Hawaii, which changes the rules. Lehua. It's different. We are seeking permission from very different places, from you, and thank you, but also from our homeland. And it's called Kahiki Nui. It's the area around the islands of Tahiti. And we actually, this past spring, took Hokulea down there to go to the sacred marae called Tapu Tapu Ate, was the great navigation school in Polynesia. And we needed to get the elders to agree we can take Hokulea outside of our homeland, Polynesia, to go to Alaska, to go to Japan, to go to China. We need permission. And so we went there, but the question is, who takes the canoe? Who asks for permission? What we needed to do was change the rules again. So we shoved Lehu outside the door. Let me tell you, she didn't want to go. And said, we're not going to put any senior captain on board. That's one change. There was no senior captain. So when the storm comes, when you turn around, nobody's there. Only people that are there is the voice of your teachers. And we threw a young crew on in their 20s. Half of them never sailed long. And the senior guys in Hawaii going, ah, this is way too dangerous, Nainoa. Don't do it. And I said, why? Because they're not ready. The question is, when are they going to be ready? Because the storms are on our doorsteps now. It's the 5-foot tide level range. They're here. They're here every day. Every day, they're here. And the great danger about storms, we don't ever see storms by themselves anymore. We see them in pairs. The power of nature, like a hurricane, is distributing heat off the earth. That's why they're so big now. That's why they're so long in duration. And that's why they're so intense. It's changing us, and we don't know what to do. The power and the magnificence of these storms, they are beautiful and very dangerous if you're not prepared. We believe that the other storm is a storm inside of us. Fear, doubt, mistrust, blame. This is long. The question that you really, we deal with is that when we face the storm, what do we choose? Courage or fear? That's why they didn't want to send them out, because they weren't tested. I went to Hilo with them. I towed them out to Kumukai. I let them go. And I was on the voyage on my little laptop thing. And we tracked them on. We have satellite tracking to watch them and a course line. And damn, I was so happy in the beginning. They were so good. Then about a quarter of the way, I was going, what? They can't make mistakes? And then I was going, wow, they are really fast. And then I start to not be okay with this. I start to examine the storm in me. I start to fear, maybe they're better than you. And my first voyage, the mom on board, took me 33 days to get to Tahiti. It took them 17. So I went down to Mangiroa, tore me into the last half mile to bring him in the strong currents there. And I don't know, I was troubled by the storm in me. And I anchored him on this massive big sandbar with all the life underneath it. Life everywhere, everything in the whole ecological system was under this canoe. And they were quietly sitting there after going 2,400 miles in record speed and excellence. Everything that we would want was demonstrated. And then what I did was I left them. I went on the beach and I walked away. They had this dinner and everything for them. I couldn't face them. When the sun went down, went black, I came back around, snuck around, got a one-man canoe, paddled out to the canoes so I could quietly, on that sandbar, pray and thank our canoes for keeping them safe. Long trip, dangerous. But I couldn't come in. I kept rubbing those canoes, and when I'm under most stress internally and when I don't know what the answers are, I go to the power of teachers They'll come to you because they work with you and they are you. And my teacher, the most important one, is my father. And in the black of the night, no moon, rubbing the canoe, my father comes and said, hey, get in. You got to go inside and you got to go thank that crew. And it was a confusing statement to me. You got to thank that crew because they were so excellent. You got to thank that crew because they're better than you. You got to thank that crew because what they demonstrated that voyaging, what they demonstrated, in my father's words, is they stopped extinction. The measurement of stopping extinction is when your students are better than you. He said, get in there and thank them. I just wanted to pass that story on about the importance of succession, breaking the rules, doing the right thing, even though it scares you. I didn't mean to do that, but what if there's anything I can leave with you folks tonight is that I disagree with Kirk, by the way, and I'll tell him why he's wrong. Our story is the same as yours. 250 years ago, stuff changes. And this is a painting of what we imagine the first arrival, spaceship of your ancestors, like going to the moon, would come from islands in the south to these Hawaiian islands that are the single most isolated, if you assume that water isolates you, high island archipelago on the planet, hard to get to. And so you're kind of looking at the arrival of maybe the, if culture is defined by our relationship to our place, then the Hawaiian people may be the youngest culture on the planet. And this, they would be here as stewards of these islands for 2,000 years. And 250 years ago, other voyagers came and brought stuff. In the next 28 years from the first arrival of other voyagers, 75% of Native Hawaiians would die. It's the same story. And then 100 years ago, there wasn't the belief that the race was going to make it. So we just changed all our values. And values like we'll outlaw culture and language in schools by policy, and private schools had the right to beat their kids. Stuff that we know. And then that same time, 1924, my father would be born. He'd be the first maybe in 100 generations where his parents would choose not to teach him language and culture and genealogy. Don't remember where you come from, because if you do, you're going to get hurt. And so there was massive changes. And I believe that I see extinction as a black, slippery road that you slide down fast enough to a cliff. At some point, you go over. And we were on that black, shiny road. And this story is not about what happened in the last 250 years. It was about our teachers who changed everything. Next slide. It began with him. I pay honor to him. He was a surfer in Santa Barbara. When you think about Hokulea, it started here. His name is Dr. Ben Finney, who was an anthropologist in Santa Barbara that was challenging the stuff that was coming out in media against the science. It didn't match up. And so he came to Hawaii to do his postdoctorate. And a woman by the name of Catherine Luamala, she was a professor there. You can count all the women professors back there in one hand. And she came to him almost in an angry voice, the story I was told, 1958, handed him two books and said, read these books, they're wrong, change it. And it was Thor Heyerdahl and the Kon-Tiki saying that, nah, they didn't know how to sail, they just drifted from the Americas because the predominant winds go that way, wrong. And the other was by Andrew Sharp, Voyagers of the Pacific, said, oh, no, we know they had canoes. He was an anthropologist, top in the world. We know they had the canoes, but they didn't have the intelligence to navigate more than 100 miles. How do you explain Hawaii? Oh, a storm blowing them 2,400 miles off course. So he took the books and waited a decade. And next slide. called this man. Not in Hawaii, he was in Chicago, but he's Hawaiian, born and raised in Waipio on the Big Island. He arguably is Hawaii's most acclaimed artist, modern day artist. He's a painter, an historian, an author, and he was the one that was taking his imagination and his research and putting history on the canvas. Name is Herb Kawainui Kane. Ben calls Herb. I don't know what they say, but out of that phone call came a dream. There came a dream. Next slide. Dream about this triangle. This is Lehua, my home. It's Hawaii up on the top, Aotearoa in the southwest, Rapa Nui in the east. It's 10 million square miles. It's 3.5 times bigger than the continental United States. It's the biggest country in the world. It's bigger than Russia and China combined. And it's, if you exclude the landmass of Aotearoa, add up the total landmass in the triangle, there's 600 times more water than land. And they were all discovered, all those islands. How'd they do it? So this is what we're trying to figure out. Next slide. And the only way that Ben and Herb figured out, you could actually figure it out, you had to build a vehicle, spaceship of your ancestors. You had to construct what they felt was replica accurate of what we think the voyaging canoes were, because we don't have any. And they were brilliant, absolutely brilliant, because they chased the dream and they acted on the dream. This is Hokulea. Hoku is star, Lea is gladness. It was seen as a navigation star that you find Hawaii from coming from Tahiti. And this is the day before she was launched. First launching of a canoe, deep sea voyaging canoe in 600 years. And it was a confusing time. And I was there just by right place at the right time, just getting dragged around by these amazing watermen. They were searching for the top watermen in Hawaii to sail this canoe. I wasn't one of them, I was like a kid, but I was training with the great watermen. And so I get luckily pulled down there. You see that circle in the back? We did ceremonies I never understood. We drank agua that I never tasted before. I didn't know why. The reconstruction of the appropriate protocols, the chance was all this rediscovery, and I didn't understand. And this canoe was confusing because there were those who would blindly pray for this canoe's success. There'd be those who simply, most in the society, didn't care. If it's Hawaiian, it has no value. Why pay attention? And there'd be those that feared this canoe. Because what if it was successful? It's going to break the rules of those who are in command. And next slide. Canoe was launched, and the big challenge was, who's going to navigate? And I'm really careful about what I say about someone else's culture. And if anybody from Micronesia is here and I offend you, I apologize. But I'm going to tell you what I was told, because I wasn't there. His name is Pialuk. His nickname is Mao. Mao means to be fierce. And what I was told that the Hawaii leadership are going to navigate themselves, navigate the canoe themselves, and kind of figure out crashing into reefs and breaking stuff. That ain't going to work. And so, in fact, the first day that we took the canoe out, we ran aground. There's 35 of us on board the canoe. We hit the sandbar. True story. The sheet lines are tied to stuff. We don't even know what a sheet line is. And in the sandbar, the captain tells everybody get off. The canoe flight floats higher now, full sail, and leaving everybody on the sandbar. And just only a few could get up. They're strong enough to get up, but it was these bodies everywhere. And then we turned it around. We got towed around. We sailed it back and didn't know how to stop it. Hit the reef. The captain gets catapulted off the bow and face first. And then he's good friend of mine, he says I can tell the story publicly, but and I was just going, wow, this is going to be a rough one, man. And because we didn't have the competence. There was no substitute on the ocean for competence. There isn't any. We didn't know what to do. So the story I was told, they were having a meeting about the leadership in Hawaii, a meeting about, well, we're just going to have to navigate it ourselves. And there was lucky. There was a Peace Corps worker by the name of Mike McCoy that was invited into the meeting and said, if you want a navigator, he's 5 miles down the road in Kewalo Basin in a University of Hawaii research ship called the Thompson Cromwell. And he's teaching scientists how to make traditional lures to catch tuna. And go ask him. He's a master. So they went to him. I wasn't there. Story of told. They said, we want you to navigate to a land you've never been to. We want you to navigate a canoe that's 8 times bigger than yours. We want you to be in a void 6 times farther than yours and sail with a crew that hasn't been selected yet. And he said yes, because he knew if he didn't go, it ain't gonna work. So he chose courage over fear. And so this changed everything. One man can make the world better. It can make it more just. And it was him. Next slide. I say VIMS is a school of navigators. This is a school called Setawa, the place that he's from, his island. It's a small island. It has no lagoons, so the Spanish and the Germans and the Japanese and the Americans had no military interests, left it alone, so they didn't kill the school. And this is Satawa out in the Western Carolines in Micronesia. It's an amazing place. Talking to the chiefs, they've been there for 4,000 years. They trained 1,000 navigators there. And Mao was seen by some, and so I'd be very careful not to be disrespectful, that there at the time there were only 6 masters left because changes were going happening in Micronesia, primarily, doctor, because elementary school kids were taken off the island and put in the residential school and broke the training. And Mao was considered in the 6, the youngest. He's the last. He is at the edge of the black rubber. And so next slide. Okay, Hawaii up in the top, Tahiti down in the bottom. Next one. All you got to do is follow that line. Doesn't exist. 2 biggest wind system, northeast trade winds, the northern ocean, northern winds and the southern winds collide on the equator. Direct heating all year long. High humidity, cloudiest and rainiest space on the earth. Very hard to see stars. And this is what Mom was going to be challenged with. Imagine you're standing on the beach of Waikiki and looking at, well, how wide is Tahiti as a target? East side to the west side, it's less than 1 degree. It's 0.6 degrees wide. And go find it with the stars. And he went. Next slide. This is an old photo of them leaving, 17 on board. And what's interesting about the chemistry of the crew that we learned from, you had part of the crew was the documentation team that was directed by their goal was to make a film from National Geographic. Part of the team was scientists who were brought on board to rewrite history in the journals of anthropology and archaeology to say the past stuff was wrong, we're replacing it. These are all important goals. Then they had those writers on board that had the job to make a book. And then you had the Hawaiian crew. And the Hawaiian crew's job was to sail this canoe, keep it dignified, and make sure nobody takes it away like everything else. The problem we didn't face, even though we were all being understood, I was not on this voyage. I flew to Tahiti and came back on the trip back, was this crew, they're all important goals. All important for the mission, but they never came together. And say they sailed as strangers. And it was a rough sail. Next slide. That was a rival. 70,000 Tahitians came to the rival. I was there. I flew down. so many children speaking their native language sunk the stern. We had to politely ask them to get off in English, and because we had to take care of this home. 17,000 Tahitians. May not sound like a big number, but it's more than half the population. Because they have the orators, they have the genealogy of the canoes, of the great navigators, but they don't have the canoe. This canoe went down there called Hokole. This is their canoe. And it changed everything because it began this beautiful pathway towards reconnecting to ancestral family. And next slide. But it wasn't without its issues or its problems. I was there, scared to death. I'm in the ocean a lot, but I never went deep sea on a canoe. And leadership, honestly, I didn't really trust. The only one I trusted was him. I never saw him in Tahiti. He was taken into hiding. He was secretly put on an Air New Zealand jet and flown to Fiji. I didn't know. And then we had a crew meeting, and leadership brought up, and you guys, well, some of you guys know, an 8-track cassette tape, that old stuff. And on it was a message from Mom. And I'm not going to tell you all the words because I don't want to. But he did say, leadership's no good in Hawaii. He was done. And he said, Kimo, send my clothes home. A bag of clothes he had in Hawaii, send it back to his island, set it all. Then he said, nobody come look for me because you'll never find me. He was, always say, his pal. He's done. We lost the master. So next slide. And for me, I was still too young to understand that you need to own your words, what you say. You need to own them. And so the way to get out, you're trying to be a young man, but you don't want to tell anybody you're scared. So what you do is you project blame on everything else. So I start talking to the crew and using the word quitting and going home. And one of our senior guys, Wally Forseth, top surfer, catamaran sailor, finds me in the youth hostel, grabs my shirt, pulls me to his face, crying. He says, boy, don't you ever use that word again. Don't you ever talk about quitting. And he just shoved me away and said, you get on this canoe, you take it home, because it's your time. It's your time. And I will never forget all of that, plus the issue. Pushing Lehua out the door, even though it was against the advice of everybody, was her time. If you trust, she can deal with the storm. And so we came home. We came home in 23 days. The trip down was 31 because we had really good winds. And one thing we didn't have, storm. So we didn't know how to deal with it. Next slide. Hokulea was only in vision and a dream for one voyage for science and books and movies. There was no, even the whole construction was for only one voyage. And she was never viewed as ever sailing back to your homeland again. But us guys who were on the wake of our ancestors, and we were on the wake of our ancestors, it was our connection to who we are as people. If the canoe went home, big celebration the day we got home. The next day, everything went back to the way it was. And we went back into that world empty, lost, but with the memory of the wake. We knew who we were as long as we were sailing. A second voyage was planned. Hindsight, poorly prepared. Didn't have the teacher. Nobody to show the way. Leadership was willing to compromise certain values that you never compromise anymore. Safety, love for the kuna crew. It was a really, really rough time. We would leave in 1978, 2 years later than the first voyage, without Mao. It was windy and rough, and we left. We were in the Alawai Canal in Waikiki, getting ready to come. Thousands of people are there. There are strangers there praying for you, and there was family there. Promises were made. and we'll come home. And leadership got up and talked to the crowd in the strong winds and said, we have a single side band radio on board. And so we have ship to shore communications. We haven't tested it yet, but if it doesn't work, don't worry. We'll call you from Tahiti in 30 days. The channel between the island of Oahu and Molokai is called Ka'iwi. Ka'iwi means the bone. It's the description of how when the opposing wind and wave stack those waves, stand them, that when it breaks, the channel turns white, like the bone. What happened that day, by nighttime, it was gale. And we called it stacking waves, where the big ones go faster than the small ones to get on top of them. And something was wrong with Hokulea around midnight. She was sluggish, and she was way too wet. The waves were busting through, and we didn't know. I woke up Bruce, the captain of Hokulea, when he came to your communities, because I trust him with my life. We opened up the hatch, put a flashlight in it, and it was pure, clear, aqua, salt water to the top of the hatch. We're flooded. And then a hydraulic, this is like timing, certain wave got on top of another wave, picked the whole canoe up because the wave was so big and rolled it all the way over. And we'll call you in 30 days. North winds going south, out of shipping lanes for sure. And then at some point out of the flight paths of most of all the aircraft. The single sideband radio was underwater, not functional. Call you in 30 days. Next slide. This is where it gets bad. For me, it's very emotional. This man, hero, the day before I came to Virginia, I buried his brother at sea. This man was considered the top big wave rider in the world. He today is credited with catching the biggest wave, 55 feet, without the assistance of tow of jet skis, just power. He was a lifeguard. He was so good that he was the only one certified to keep this beach safe called Waimea Bay on the north side of Oahu. Huge surf. He was the only one that was certified. Nobody else could do it. Nobody was good enough like him. And there are stories, I didn't see it. I see stories where he would go out. This is pre-jet skis, just his fins and a rescue tube. But he dragged two guys in at once, drunk, caught in the shore bay, dragged out. He drags them up to the beach, into this, get them up enough high water, and just tell them, don't you ever, ever come down to this beach again. In the record book of the city and county who he worked for, they got a log every time they got to have a rescue attempt. In the log, it's well over 600 attempts at Waimea Bay. But there's a column of those that say, how many did you lose? The number is zero. The best. But Eddie Aiko, what he was is a hero. Not the fabricated kinds that we kind of acted they are for children on TV. He's real, quiet, bold, strong, best, highest level of excellence. Children, everybody loved him. And but especially children looked at him and said, wow, that's the bar. That's the standard. That's great. And Hawaiian, because it's connected to salt water. Next slide. This is a picture of a picture that his family gave to me. And he's sitting on a surfboard in the Alawai Canal next to Hokulea. You see that white edge on the left side of that slide? That's the color of the board. And he went to the captain. It's all about leadership decisions. It's all about it. He went to the captain and said, can I put the surfboard on the canoe? I want to surf Tahiti. And the captain said, yes. Put the surfboard on the canoe. And then to understand him from what little I knew about him, he was so powerful that I was so intimidated. I didn't even want to. I mean, how does the world's greatest waterman try out for a crew of Hokulea? I mean, and so, but in trying out, you had to go get your medical stuff. So we had this place called the Honolulu Medical Group on the fourth floor. We're getting our inoculation. They're testing whether you can breathe and you got a pulse and that kind of stuff. And so by chance, I walked out and I was getting into the elevator and Eddie walks out of another room and comes into the elevator with me. And now I'm in the elevator with the world's greatest waterman. And I'm like with him, but he wasn't with me. You know, those doors on the elevator, they close. They got these stainless steel, like couplers, these old elevators, they close. And he was tapping that stainless steel. And he was just thinking about something far away. And then he, when the doors opened, he left the elevator. I stayed in the elevator. And then he walks into the lobby and he turns around and goes, you know, Nainoa, I need to sail on Hokulea. I need to go down the road of my ancestors. I need to look back in the wake to see my kupuna, my ancestors. We need to pull Tahiti out of the sea and give it to the elders so they can give it to children. I need to sail to Tahiti to pull the island out of the sea. We overturned around midnight. In the morning, it'd be like 42 feet, maybe 40 feet of one keel was above sea level. The seas are big, 15, 18 feet. And you had the other one completely submerged. And you had a crew of 14 sitting on that sharp edge of the keel, and the waves kept knocking us off. And you got to get back up. It's north winds. You guys know hypothermia way better than us. But once you're chilled, you're done. And so the waves kept knocking us off. At sunrise, you see Eddie in front of the captain. Now, if you're like two seats away from somebody, you couldn't talk to them because the wind was so strong. So you couldn't hear what Eddie was saying, but you knew what he was asking. Let him go, because we had the surfboard. And then you see Eddie sit down. And then everybody keeps getting knocked off, drifting south, north winds, cold. And then about, I don't know, mid-morning or so, you see Eddie back up again in front of the captain. Again, you don't know what he said, but you know what he's asking. The golden rule is you never leave the ship. But call you in 30 days, nobody knows. You see someone tie a black knitted bag around Eddie's waist, put a bag of poi and oranges inside, put a life jacket around his neck, jumped in the surfboard. And I'm nobody. I'm just a crew member. But this is all wrong. And so Eddie's putting his stuff in. I swim out to him. I grab his arm. And I ask him, because I didn't know what to say. It's just, this is wrong. Eddie, is this the right thing to do? And he just pulled his arm away. And then he went, climbing these waves. And he'd lose him in the trough. The problem with that story is it's called Ehukai. Every time a wave breaks, it emits some salt into the atmosphere. You have infinite amount of waves breaking in the gale. And so it's like a fog on the ocean. It's a fog. We call it Ehukai. It was so thick, you couldn't see the island of Oahu. You could see just the very top of a mountain called Kamalo on Molokai and the top of Lanai Hale. But they're far away. Eddie didn't have good eyesight. When the sun goes down, Eddie paddled to an island he couldn't see. He paddled to an island, can't see. We get rescued by miracle by the Coast Guard. Little airport. Hundreds of people are there. I didn't know anybody, except I recognize an old white rusty van. It's Eddie's father's van. And I assumed he made it, because how would they know? How would they rescue us? And so in ignorance, I went over to the van, opened the door, and there was Eddie's powerful father in the driver's seat, his mother and beautiful mother in the back seat. And I will regret these words for the rest of my life. I said, "Where's Eddie?" Eddie didn't make it. And I will never forget the sound of the mother wailing into the gale, calling her son home. I've never seen Hawaii in such trauma. Everybody was flying. Coast Guards were falsifying missions and at 2,000 feet, and Civil Air Patrol, Coast Guard, people were renting helicopters, light planes, people out there in fishing boats. Nobody was fishing in the gale. They weren't fishing. They're hunting. Coast Guard, after 48 hours, would call it off. Nobody's going to survive that. But maybe it was day 10, and they wouldn't call it off. People were searching every island, disconnected communities, thinking, maybe he made it. Maybe he's got hurt in the rocks. We're going to go find him. And everybody only had one thing that they could strive, hope they could hang on. Let's just look for him. It wasn't the Coast Guard that called it off. It was Eddie's father. Eddie's family is the caretakers of the Chinese graveyard north of Punch Bowl. They live on the graveyard in this old wooden house. They are to be considered financially very, very poor people, but they're the most strong, caring, forgiving family I know. Press conference is called, crew is called, we go to the house. They have a small wooden dinner table. Pop Psychol was there. They had all the microphones and everything else, and the tape recorders all there, and the cameras. And Pop Psychol goes, "Okay, Hawaii, today you stop." Stop looking for my son. Let him go. Because the family doesn't want anybody else to get hurt. And we were broken. One of the great painful fears of being Hawaiian when I was raised is shame. The level of shame that we were dealing with was unbearable. The only response to it was to hide. I'm a commercial fisherman. I fish by myself. Nighttime, I would look at the stars, never dreaming anymore. Never dreaming. I didn't have any other friends. It was a very dangerous time. And next slide. Yeah, Hawaii was broken. The vision for the canoe, now that it's too dangerous, take it out of the water, put it in the Bishop Museum lawn to make sure nobody can get hurt. Nobody can get hurt anymore. But there was a different vision that was going on amongst our elders. Next slide. They viewed Hokulea as the light for the future of Native Hawaiians. That it was the ability to be able to demonstrate that their ancestors were the best. And therefore, you should be proud. And the elders were saying, if the legacy of Hokulea becomes defined by its tragedy, then not only would we, how many generations would we have to go through to forget that story of light, to create another dream And they were saying they don't know. They don't know how many more generations of pain they're going to have to go through. And they were saying that you're going to have to change. You're going to have to break the rules. I was sitting on the beach looking at the stars when he came to me. I wouldn't look into my eyes because there's too much shame in them. Put his hand on my shoulder and says, this man was many things. He was playing football in Maui when Pearl Harbor was bombed. Military game, machine guns. He didn't know how to shoot to go defend the beaches from the invasion of the Japanese. He goes home and his father says, you go and fight for your land. If you make shame, you'll come home. And he didn't talk about those days, too much hurt. But his friend Ramohoma said, yeah, your father falsified his birth certificate, went to Washington State, tried to get in. He got into the military and he was made a first scout. They thought he was Native American. True story. And he landed in Normandy and watched his friends die. Then he fought 400 miles across French soil, white snow and green fatigues. German sniper shot him in the head. Took out his left side of his face, took out his eye, exited his nose. A guy from Oklahoma, my father won't talk about this time, would come to my house and I would just bug him about, tell me about my dad. Said, yeah, you know, your dad, they had piles in the front lines where limited medical supplies, that only gave what they had to those that thought they were going to survive. He was put in the other pile. And that Oklahoma man and another man said, no, no, no. They put him on a cot and they carried him behind the lines to get him help. And the other man stepped on the line, a landmine was killed. Shrapnel went to my father, too close to internal organs, never removed. Rough stuff. He knows what it is to fight. And it was in the New York hospital that they bandaged both eyes for 2 years so that they could try to repair the left eye. Didn't work. But that's when my father talks. He said, in the black of the bandage, I had the time to think through what is important in my life. And he came up with two decisions. Come home and protect and help children that need it the most, that society serves the least. Poor children. We were the poor children. We were broken. Puts his hand on my shoulder, goes, me and mom have been talking. You need to go. We'll be there when you leave, Nainoa, and we'll be there when you arrive. But you don't know how to do this. You don't know how to do this. I want a meeting with your leadership tomorrow in the biomedical building at UH. I remember that day. It was dark. It was dingy. And we weren't looking at each other. We're in the room and he started to talk about, stand up, get up. And then he started to talk about values of vision, community. And the big thing was training. It's 95% of the success in voyaging is determined before you leave. The 5% is up to nature. He got us fully clear of a sail plan that would work as long as we executed the training. So we'd go outside in the parking lot and my life would change forever. It was bright light, blue sky, making me squint, and this dark object's coming at me angry. And he goes, hey, Nainoa, you want to navigate? It's my father. Who's your teacher? Remember the 8-track cassette tape? Don't come. Look for me. You'll never find me. My father said, here, he don't come, you don't go. Word gets around in Micronesian island to island. I get on a plane. I didn't find Mao. Next slide. He let me find him. We sat on a white sand beach, driftwood log, head down. The thing about this man, he's the greatest navigator on the earth, but the choices to navigate are made out of decisions that are filtered through compassion and care and love. Love is the only solution, by the way, to the future we seek. And he lived it, had his head down. He didn't want to come back to Hawaii. So I was just fumbling. I just said, Mao, we really need you. And this was a question that I think back and go, wow, you are really stupid. What I asked him was, we don't need you to find Tahiti for us. We need to find it. Will you teach? You're asking him to break a 4,000-year couple, a rule, because they never, Micronesia, they have different schools of different islands. Micronesia, even if you're on the same island, even different families have different schools. He has come from a school called Voyaging, the most powerful school in Micronesia. He is the highest rank, the best. And then some nobody from Hawaii goes, will you teach? And he just said, well, we'll see. I go home. First thing my dad said, you don't come, you don't go. Those are the rules. I get a phone call from his son, Henry, in Saipan, 2 months later and goes, oh, Mao's coming to your house tomorrow. Freaked out my neighbors. I was a commercial fisherman, lived by myself. I only had one pair of shorts, no food, and I didn't need food. And the greatest navigator is going to live with you. That thing is not going to work. And so he only came 3 days and he moved out to my mom and dad's house. And then he would take us by the hand, like children, pull us through the window of time into the old ocean that nobody else could have done. So when I say this is about teachers, I mean it. Nobody could have done that. 25 years. We would sail to Tahiti. Took us twice the time as Lehua did, but we won't bring that up again. He was on board. We broke stuff. I was lost half the time. It was hard. It was hard sailing because we knew so little. Ignorance was just, it was just overrunning us, but he was there and he was patient. And when we got back to Hawaii, went down to Tahiti and came back, he's packing his bag to go home because he hadn't gone home for 28 months. Stay with you all the way. That's our definition of the teacher. Stay with you all the way. So in the times that you're weakest and you fall down, they pick you up and give you strength. 28 months every day in the ocean. If we didn't touch salt water, you maybe swim nighttime in the rough at night to touch the water as a commitment to the navigation. It was hard, but it was amazing. And he sits me down and he goes, okay, Nainoa, the summary of the voyage. You did okay. But he said, if you want someone to know everything, send your son because you're too old. I'm in my early 20s. And he goes, tells a story about his grandfather who was going to be his teacher to graduate him. And he said, yeah, when he was 1 year old, the grandfather would put him in different tide pools in different parts of the island to play with nature. Hear the bird, smell the salt, touch sand, and listen to the whistle of the forest and keep moving them around the island. He was sailing at age 5 and on the deep sea voyaging canoe. And Ma would start to illustrate with his hands. Yeah, I'm with my grandfather on the voyaging canoe. When the wave come and lift the canoe up, when wave go by, the canoe go back down. And he keeps lifting it up and going down. It makes me sick. He's seasick. Said, so my grandfather tie my hands and throw me overboard. Try that at VIMS. Yeah. And drag him beyond the canoe. And he says that whole story, Mao would say, was a deep love for his grandfather. Because he said, my grandfather put me in the ocean so I can go in the ocean. When I go in the ocean, I can go inside the wave. When I go inside the wave, I become the wave. And when I become the wave, then I'm navigator. Navigators have no separation from nature. You either you are nature or you're not a navigator. Really simple. I watched him in times where we would be training. He'd sleep inside the hull of the canoe, inside the hull of the canoe on the bottom. And he would tell me instructions of what star lines to follow. Of course, when he's sleeping, I'm going to try something else. I don't want to try it, but I didn't ask permission. And so I go check, making sure he's sleeping before I change the course. And his eyes are closed. So he stays in there the whole night. I'm kind of going all over the place. And he says, when he comes up at sunrise, he goes, oh, man, I saw those red eyes. It's like, oh, man, I'm in trouble. And he looks at me like, where you go last night? And I was so terrified, I wouldn't answer him. He goes, where you go last night? And I wouldn't answer him. I said, where did I tell you to go? And I told him, the star line was called Waller. And he looks at me and goes, you know, I see you come inside to see if I'm sleeping. He goes, my eyes are closed, but here never sleeps as a navigator. It's the magic. It's the deep side that we don't understand. It's what we chase. That's when I say we're in kindergarten, we are. Because that deep side in here is complete 100% trust and love in your ancestors, your teachers, the canoe, the ocean, nature. It's that level of trust that we're not there because we still live in a world where we start to measure it against fear and distrust. So we're trying. Next slide. 25 years, he comes back. We sailed a lot in the Pacific to all the major islands of Polynesia. We went as far north as Alaska, or west of Japan, far south as New Zealand. A lot of traveling within our country. Feel the sense of you evolving your mission to what matters, that sometimes if the world is changing quickly, that if you don't move with that change, you become irrelevant if you're only doing what you did yesterday. And so it's not easy. It's hard to make those kinds of adjustments when you have such high respect for yesterday. But you have to. That's where breaking the rules comes from. Next slide. And to some degree, it was because of this. Apollo 8. 1968, the first time human beings would go outside the gravity of the Earth and slingshot around the gravity of the moon. And William Anders would take this photograph of the Earth, which would be called the Earthrise, and would be credited with moving the environmental movement globally. But back then it was green. Wrong. The planet's blue, by the way. And it was about hugging trees. It was kind of on the side. But one thing it did, next slide. But I do want you to know him real quick. He's my best friend. He's Hawaii's second astronaut in space. His name is Lieutenant Colonel Lacey Beach. And there's a long story about him. And real quick, next slide. He loved his canoe. He said, someone asked him, what is it like to explore? He goes, no, when you're in a shuttle, it's like you're going really fast around the Earth in a can of spam. He said, if you want to know a real exploration, go on Hokulea. Next slide. And then he flew the shuttle. He said, the reason why I go into space is I want to get outside the boundaries of gravity and be able to do one thing, turn around and look at the beauty of the Earth, its whole entirety, and why we need to protect it. So his whole thing was getting exploration to children. Next slide. That's a stone axe that his grandfather gave him, is using to build voyaging canoes that he smuggled into Colombia and then put it in the window and floated there in zero gravity. That's the island of Hawaii on the bottom of the cockpit window. And that little red dot, if you kind of look by the edge of the clouds, is Kanakakoi. That's on the 12,500-foot elevation of Mauna Kea, where there was an adze quarry that made this kind of stone that was the hardest because it was the emergence of volcanism when the mountains were glaciers. And so they would make this stone to build canoes. He smuggles it on board and says, I have a present for you. And he said, this is the ingredients to heal the Earth. make sure we understand and respect and honor 500 years back, at least, of our ancestors. Couple it with the power of science and technology. But the main thing is that you have to have the right values to navigate that. Caring, compassionate values. Next. He flew in 92. He sailed with us. Hokulea was going up, and we did this exchange from the shuttle to Hokulea to 30,000 school kids in Hawaii about exploration. But then he met us on the island of Molokai. I was coming back in the arrival ceremony. Something was wrong with him. This is 92. And then, but he started to get urgent with me. He says, you know, you can't protect what you don't understand, and you won't if you don't care. That's why love matters. And you can't do it by yourself. The whole layer around the world. He's planting the seed. It wasn't us who decided to go around the world. It was him. Next slide. Things are going wrong. He was sick, lymphomelanoma. Late September 95, his wife would call me and said, you got to get on a plane today. Come see your friend. I flew to Houston, and in that dark house, 100 people were there. I couldn't find Lacey. I asked his wife, Alice, where is he? He's in the bedroom waiting for you. So I come in the bedroom, and to make a long story short, this is where instructions for teachers become promises from us. It's what drives us in Voyaging. Mao, my father, Lacey, and 1,000 others. But Lacey said, he said, you make me 3 promises today, Nainoa. One is, pay attention to the language. New language that humanity doesn't know, climate change, sustainability, hypoxia, dead zones. He had a long list of the language. He said, pay attention to this language. And then he said, sail Hokulea around the world. Promise me you're going to do it. I said, okay. And then he said, and why I'm so proud and honored and hopeful to be here, he said, go build a school for the earth around the values of your ancestors and the power of science. Bingo. He says, build the school for the earth. And so he said, promise me, Nainoa. So I did. 6 days later, he died. Next slide. The first promise was the language. Second promise was the voyage. This was why we went. Because 13 years from when he died in 1995, we didn't move. Leadership would get together every year, vote on that year's agenda, and every time the worldwide voyage would come up, we'd talk about the amazing vision that was and how important it was. But once we went to risk, what about the hurricane or the pirate or the rogue wave of South Africa or the mosquito or the violence of Yemen, Somalia, the Red Sea? We would vote together, unanimous, no. 13 years. And doctor, what would happen on April 1st, 2008, the language was so loud that we couldn't hide from the language that the earth is yelling at us. Do something about the earth. Lacey was correct. The language was screaming at us. So we had a vote. It wasn't about whether we needed to go or not. We had to go. The question was, what's more dangerous? The pirate, the hurricane, the rogue wave, the mosquito, human violence, or staying tied to the dock and understand what's happening and do nothing about it? What's more dangerous? We voted 4 times. It had to be unanimous because this was going to take all of us. And we got to unify. I'll leave you there today. I mean, I have tons more. You want to stay here? I'll stay here all night. But I didn't want to leave this room with you not understanding the power of teachers and how the integration between science and technology and wisdom and the history and the remembering about what sustainability really was. Because you've been here for 10, maybe 12,000 years. And you're here in the room defining what we need to do. honored to be here, guys. Privileged. Really want to work with you guys on this voyage to help everybody learn about your excellence, about your courage, about the definition of unity, about your care, your kindness, your compassion. It's a story for the earth, the anchor for the Atlantic Ocean. In our minds in Hawaii, is right here, on your land, in your school. Thank you.
This was a really moving day for me and for us. I'm so grateful to have the chiefs here with us today, and so thankful to Nainoa and to Lehua for joining us. Nainoa commented that you learned so much from us today, but what we learned from you is every bit as important. And so I'm really excited about where we can go with this partnership. Thank you all again for coming tonight.